Hello and welcome to this Insights video on the Verdi Requiem. My name's Catherine Wren and I'm a viola player with the RSNO, and I'm absolutely delighted today to welcome the RSNO's chorus director, Stephen Doughty. Stephen, you've been in the post about a year now. Can you tell us how it feels and how you're fitting into the organisation here?
From my perspective, I'm having a great time. I'm very much enjoying working with the chorus. Such a fabulously inspired and talented group of singers. You're probably better to ask them how they think I'm fitting in, but I'm very much enjoying being part of the organisation, just part of the RSNO family. So many other opportunities to enjoy having a group of 120 very talented singers to direct. It's been very much enjoyable and I'm enjoying it very much. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about your role with the chorus and how you prepare them for a big piece like the Verdi with the orchestra?
So my role with the chorus, I'm the chorus director as opposed to the musical director. So my role is primarily to prepare the chorus for performances that are coming up with the RSNO as part of the season. I respond to the instructions from somebody else. So I will be in discussion with the conductor of whatever the project happens to be, and he or she will say, can I have this, can I have that? Or I will suggest we're going to do this or we're going to do that. Is that okay with you? And then I prepare the chorus according to their wishes, if you like, or as I see it should be prepared. But then, of course, when it gets to the concert week, I have that scary moment of handing the chorus over to the maestro and hoping that they remember all the things we've been preparing, and obviously hoping that the maestro will be happy with the performance of the chorus, both in the rehearsals and in the concerts that are coming up.
Once we're into the rehearsal period with the orchestra and the conductor, you're sitting at the back of the hall, but you're not doing nothing, are you? You still have a role to play, even though you're not directly conducting the chorus anymore. Yeah. Can you tell us what that role is?
Sometimes it's simply sitting, as you say, sitting at the back of the hall, but if it's to do with balance, I might be able to say to the conductor, the orchestra's too loud at that point, or to the choir, you need to sing out more at that point. Sometimes it'll be a case of the conductor might want the music to be done differently at that moment. Occasionally there'll be things that we've done in rehearsal. Perhaps I've been too specific in what I've asked him to do in rehearsal, but the conductor is obviously doing it differently, but the choir perhaps not picking it up. So I will interject and say, please could you make sure you follow this or don't do that, as we've been doing. So it depends on the piece in question. And likewise, the conductor is sometimes much more interactive with me in terms of how does this sound? How is the chorus doing this? Can you hear the chorus over that? So it's a bit of give and take at that process, yeah.
So Stephen, can you tell us a little bit more about how Verdi came to write this piece and how it fits into his work?
I think we always assume in all these great works that they came off the page and were instant classics, but that just really wasn't the case at all. Back in 1871, Verdi had said, there are so many, many requiems out there, why do I need to write another one? But in 1868, his good friend and the very famous Italian composer Rossini died. And Verdi, along with a dozen or so other Italian composers of the day, got together to write a Messa de Rossini, which was going to be a funeral mass for Rossini. And Verdi started the process. He wrote the last movement, the Libera Me, and the other composers were going to submit the other movements. And the original conductor was also on board. But only 9 days before the intended date of this performance, the project fell flat. People blame various things, but I think one of the reasons was the conductor at the time just kind of lost interest, and so the whole thing died a death. But there was a cultural movement going on at the time, it's called the Risorgimento, the rising again of Italian culture. It was a movement to kind of bring together all the different facets of Italian life and the different dialects of the Italian language. And one of the key movers in this was an Italian author called Manzoni, and he was somebody who Verdi had admired all of his adult life. He died around the same time, and Verdi thought it would be a nice idea to write a requiem in his memory, in his honour. So Verdi took it upon himself to write the complete requiem, which at the time was called the Manzoni Requiem. And it wasn't really until the early 20th century that it started receiving the fame that it has today.
One of the first things that strikes me is the political background to it. And I guess thinking about Manzoni in particular and the influence that mm-hmm. that brought in, it obviously travelled well mm-hmm. and continues to travel well. But to what extent do you feel it's a really quintessentially Italian piece, or is it more international than that? I don't know.
Well, I think when you hear the piece, even though it is a religious text, you really can't escape the operatic feeling behind it, both in the drama of the choral writing, but also in the style of the various arias that are throughout the piece.
Yeah. So I'm dying to know, I have my own real shiver moment in this piece of music. I mean, it's that kind of mm-hmm. music. I'm going to ask you, what is your shiver down the spine moment?
The awesome majesty, if it doesn't sound too poetic, of the Dies Irae, when the whole thing just builds and builds and builds, and then the chorus come in, they just burst into life. It's just a tremendous moment. But then immediately after that finishes, there's just complete silence.
Yes.
And it's that moment when you're just aware of the mm-hmm. the power, you kind of get sucked into the power of the Dies Irae, but then it stops and it's just completely silent. Mm-hmm. That's a very special moment for me.
I love the a cappella mm-hmm. moment in the mm-hmm. Liberame, and it's almost a shock, isn't it, to go from that big orchestra mm-hmm. to that small a cappella sound.
Yeah, and I think when you, for the audience point of view, when they're looking at it,
yes.
it's just so unusual in a piece such as this
yes.
to see all the violins, they put the violins down, all the woodwind players, yeah. they put the instrument down,
yeah.
and there's just no orchestral sound at all.
Yeah.
That's quite yeah. unusual in a
yeah.
in a choral work of that size
yeah.
with such a big orchestra yeah. at your disposal.
Yeah. Yeah. And then the moment of terror as the soprano starts the next section mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. that top C for
yes.
me, that
yeah.
that is yeah. the moment of the piece,
yes.
just
yeah.
this final moment of drama.
It is, yeah, drama is the word.
Drama
yeah.
is the
you,
word,
you can't
isn't
escape
it?
That from the piece from beginning to end.
Yeah.
And to finish at the very end so quietly. Yes, wonderful, wonderful.
So there is a lot of drama in the Requiem, obviously. I mean, it is about the process of somebody dying mm-hmm. and all the rest of it. But I mean, it's not all doom and gloom in the Verdi Requiem,
certainly.
Is it? There are moments of brightness in there.
Oh, certainly, yeah. And the one that immediately jumps out at you is the Sanctus,
mm-hmm.
which is completely cheerful. The choir is divided into double choir. The tune of the fugue appears all over the place. Bright F major. I think there's hardly, much like Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony, there's
yeah.
hardly a minor key chord in the Sanctus at all. It's a complete overt statement of joy, which, as you say, is completely the opposite style to so much of the rest of the piece, which is much more to do with the Day of Wrath, if you like.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's a great, great fun moment to sing. But as you say, a completely different contrast to the rest of the piece. Yeah.
It's kind of an emotional respite in the piece, though, isn't it? It's a moment of fun, actually.
Yes,
if I'm going to talk as a player, I mean, it's really fun to play that. And you're right. I mean, that fugue, it's as Brahms said, it's it really shows the mastery
yes,
of Verdi
yeah.
as a composer, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, I mean, if one wants to sit down and study it in detail, as I have, I'm sorry to say, it's very precisely worked out. All the fugal subjects are in the right place. You can turn all the counterpoint upside down and it works as it should.
Mm-hmm.
It's clearly a work of somebody that knows exactly what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
As Brahms says, it clearly is the work of a genius, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the things I really love about working with the chorus, actually, is that coming together mm-hmm. of orchestra and chorus. I mean, from our point of view, it's not really fair to say that the rehearsals are dull, but there's definitely that feeling of mm-hmm. something missing that, you know, we have 2 or 3 days of working as an orchestra, working in detail on our part. We might see the soloist just for one afternoon mm-hmm. before we draw the whole thing together. I wonder how that feels from the chorus's point of view as well. When is it in the process that they first see the orchestra?
Just in the few days before the concert,
mm-hmm.
Which is another scary moment which can happen.
Yeah.
All the rehearsals prior to this are purely with piano. Sometimes the rehearsals will be a separate sectional rehearsal, so we'll take part of the choir separately to focus on particularly a bit the Sanctus that we've been talking about,
yeah.
which is a double choir. Sometimes it's easier to actually rehearse that with the choir in two separate sections. But all of these rehearsals are just done with myself and with piano in a very antiseptic environment, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just in the days leading up to the concert that the whole body, the RSNO orchestra and the RSNO chorus come together for the first time. And so the chorus has to get used to, rather than having the sound of the piano, we have the sound of the orchestra to contend with. Sometimes there are specific things which we need to be aware of. if, let's say, just the final chord of the piece for sake of argument, doing it with the piano, it comes very much, the choir and the piano can sound exactly at the same time. If you transpose or translate rather that same thing to the choir with the orchestra, and the orchestra, by the time the sound emerges, it's a less accented thing than particularly in a soft chord. So if the choir has been trained to sing exactly on the beat, then when it all comes together in rehearsal, the choir will always sound early. So part of my job is also having that in mind. So places like that, I will actually train the choir to sing late, mm-hmm. if you look mm-hmm. at it from that point of view, mm-hmm. so that when they come to put together with the orchestra, the end result will be hopefully that the two things will marry up. Mm-hmm. So there's a definite change in how the piece fits together when we come together with the orchestra. Mm-hmm. But that is very much in just the few days before the concert itself. Mm-hmm. So concert week is very exciting.
Yeah, I'm sure. I was going to say that actually, there always seems a real buzz mm-hmm. When we get together for the first time. Is it an exciting moment for the chorus to
hear
the orchestra?
So it's very exciting for them because mm-hmm. quite apart from the general wall of sound, just the whole process and seeing all these instruments mm-hmm. and the whole thing fitting together, it's a very exciting time, yeah.